So we continue in numerical methods. And yeah, we are finished with the Monte Carlo method. And if you remember the beginning of our discussion of the Monte Carlo method, we were recalling the drawing of a random variable. So many of our convergence results were formulated by looking at the sequence of IID random variables. So this here is Xi is a sequence of IID random variables, so without the omega, yeah. So Xi, later I dropped the tilde, is a sequence of IID random variables. Okay, and then when we were looking at the Monte Carlo integral, we were considering evaluating an event, yeah, so we had Xi is evaluate this sequence of IID random variables at a single omega. So, and this here is now a sequence of, say, random numbers. So our results on the convergence were looking at the sequence of IID random variables. But then when we apply the method, we looked at the single event and had a sequence of numbers. And now I like to implement this in the computer. So I need an algorithm that generates sequence of random numbers, and this is a random number generator. And I would like to discuss a little bit random number generation. And I will start with the pseudo random number generator. Again, if you recall the Monte Carlo method applied as an integration rule, so the Monte Carlo integration, you saw that actually we started by looking at random numbers on 0, 1. And since you know if you have a sequence, a one-dimensional sequence, you can generate a sequence on a multi-dimensional space, yeah, by just populating the components. Yeah. So this gives also sequences on 0, 1 to the power of d. Okay, and we will look later at how we can generate other distributions, so distributions different from the uniform one. Yeah, but for the Monte Carlo integration, it was sufficient to consider sequences that are uniform on 0, 1. So let's start with pseudo random number generators. Okay, so what does the name pseudo-random mean? So it means that it's very hard to predict the next number and it looks random. Yeah? So that's here a strange thing. So how should I define this? So it looks random, but it is still a deterministic algorithm. So you expect that certain measures, statistical measures, look right. Yeah. So the expectation should have should look right, or you should have the right way to converge to the expectation. Variance should look right, and so on. But it's still an algorithm that generates this. So the term here, very hard, it looks very hard, yeah, it's not very precise, okay? A classic example for such an algorithm that generates a sequence of numbers that look random, yeah, are the linear concurrential generators. Well, for very important applications, you should not use these generators because they look good, yeah. But if you look a little bit closer, you see that the numbers are actually of a bit poor quality. Yeah, I have a result on the next slide that illustrates this. But at a first look, they look good. Okay, so how is a linear concurrential random number generator defined? So a linear concurrential random number generator is here in definition 18. So it has a certain set of parameters. So first of all, the initial value of my sequence is a given parameter here. There is an x0. Okay. And this generator here generates integers. So integers between 0 included and m not included. So the last integer that it generates, or the largest possible integer that it generates, is m minus 1. Okay, and how is this done? So we take the initial value and then we multiply the initial value with a given other parameter a. Okay, so this parameter a is given. Then in addition, we add another parameter, and that other parameter is now here the c. So we take a times x, so x is our initial value for the starting point, and we calculate just a linear function a times x plus c. And then we take all that modulus m. So mod m means, yeah, so you, if you are larger than m, you jump back to 0. So it's like a little bit when we looked at integers represented in the computer, but just with a different number. Yeah, for integers, it was 2 to the power of 32, yeah, until you flip to the next value. Yeah, because we had 2 to the power of 32 different values. And here it is mod m. So I can draw a little bit the same picture that we had already for integers. So I have a circle here. So we start here with the number 0. Okay. And then we have here m minus 1, m minus 2, m minus 3. And when we are larger than m minus 1, we flip back to 0. So that's the mod, okay? Modulus m. Now think that a and c are quite large and m is not so large. Okay, m is also large, but it's not so large. Then if you perform here this operation, and my initial value is between 0 and m. So look here, my initial value is between 0 and m. The result of this linear transformation, multiply with a and add c, will likely be larger than m. So it means that you could go here around, and maybe you get around many times. And then you look at what is the number where you stop. So this is a little bit like a wheel of fortune. That's so funny. This is like a wheel of fortune. Okay, so you go around this circle and then you stop at a certain number. So of course this plus C here is there because if I would start at 0, I would always stay at 0. Yeah. So a is a little bit the velocity I'm hitting this. Yeah. But the velocity also depends on where I am. Yeah. So 0, 1, 2. Yeah. So and if I'm in 0, I would then stuck at 0. So the wheel is always turned a little bit with a constant to ensure that I always get to some other position. Okay, maybe it's an art to choose the right coefficients, so a, c, and m. Okay, so this generator generates here integer numbers between 0 and m minus 1. So if we like to have a uniform distributed number, a pseudo-random number that looks like being uniform on 0, 1, we need to transform this. So this here generates integers in the set from 0 to m minus 1. So if we like to have a floating point number in, say, 0 included, 1 not included, we use, say, my floating point number zi is the xi divided by m, okay, as a float. So maybe if I would do this as a programmer, I would have to convert this to a floating point number divided by m, otherwise it would be integer division. Okay, and you see this transformation zi is xi divided by m will give me here a random number in this range. So 0 is included, but 1 is not included. Okay, so that is a very popular random number generator. Many built-in generators, so the trivial ones, the simple ones, are of this form. Yeah. So in MATLAB, in R, in C, in C++, Java, Scala, yeah, the normal, yeah, the trivial random number generators are such generators, maybe with sometimes different coefficients, A, C, and M. They are good for small experiments, yeah, but they have not so good properties if you look, for example, to higher dimensions. So, for example, just one result here. Such a linear concurrential random number generator. So it generates values between 0 and m minus 1. So we have for this generator that the period length, so that's here, is at most m. So after m points, it's guaranteed that the sequence repeats. Yeah, so why is that? Because the new value just depends on the previous value. So if the previous value is the same number than any number that has appeared before, the sequence will be the same as that sequence that had been appeared before. And since I can only generate m different numbers, after m numbers, it's for sure that the next number is a number that has already appeared. And from that on, the sequence repeats. So the period length of this generator is at most m. It can generate at most m different numbers. And then if you go to higher dimension, such a linear concurrential random number generator has the defect that a higher dimensional random number generated by populating the components one by the other, so according to our rule that we once had, they lie on at most m to the power of 1 divided by d hyperplanes. So if m is now a fairly large number, for example, in Java, m is a fairly large number. Java util random uses m is 2 to the power of 48. Yeah, that's 2 times 10 to the power of 14, yeah, a fairly large number. So I would hope that the period length is somewhere around that. But if you use 2 dimension, it's already 10 to the 7. Yeah? So after 10 to the 7, you get a number that lies on the same, not the same number, but on the same hyperplane. Yeah? So they have a linear dependency. And if you go to higher dimension, this property becomes worse. The next random number generator I like to just mention is Mersenne-Twister. It's a very popular and very good random number generator for random numbers on 0, 1. So it's called Mersenne Twister, or it's called MT19937. Okay, strange name. And this random number generator has a huge period length. So the period length of this random number generator is 2^90,937. Yeah, so that's the number in that appeared in this name, minus one. So actually they are achieving this by having a random number generator where this the sequence is generated from the previous value is actually operating on a very much larger value. Actually, they are using 64 different words, yeah, so 64 different integers to generate the state of this random number generator. Yeah? So they are just enlarging maybe this integer. And there are another some other tricks inside this generator. Yeah? It's not a linear concurrential generator on just a larger size of bits. So this means the random number generated from a random number sequence generated from this random number generator here has a guaranteed period lengths. So it repeats for the first time after these number of sample points. So, and how about this property if you use this random number to generate random numbers in higher dimensions? So the disadvantage of the linear concurrential ones. So it's actually shown that this is a good approximation for a uniform sequence in the higher dimensions up to dimension 623. So maybe that is useful if we like to calculate very high dimensional integrals. Okay, so maybe now you frown. Okay, would we really go into the situation that we calculate integrals in 623 dimension? And I can tell you in this lecture, yes, we will. Because if you look later in the discretization of stochastic processes, then actually time discretization is a dimension. So if you make a time discretization that has 100 time steps, it's actually a 100 dimensional integration. But we will look at this later. Okay, so that's just mentioning another generator, which I sometimes use. So I sometimes use Mersenne Twister. I like to finish with a small numerical experiment. So now we have random number generators. And here in the beginning of the lecture, we had this small remark. So I hope you have not forgotten that we generate a sequence of random vectors by populating here the components, one by the other, using a one-dimensional sequence. And I would just like to implement this to maybe show you a little bit how it looks like. Now using our standard Java linear concurrential generator. So let's go here and we do some experiment. So maybe I call this here new class, and I call this package here, maybe not Monte Carlo integration, this is now random numbers. And we call it maybe random vector plot. I like to have a main method. So now I like to generate, say, 100 different sample points. So let's have an integer, the number of sample points, say 100 different sample points. So I have a loop. So I do it with a classical loop here. I is smaller than number of sample points. And now I draw a random number. Yeah? So double x is... So I need a random number generator. So let's use here the standard Java random class, random of, say, a new random. And okay, I need to import that. So from that random number generator, I use next double. And now it's maybe interesting to read a little bit the Java doc, the Java documentation. So you see here, this returns the next pseudo random uniform distributed double value between 0 and 1 from this random number generator. Okay. And you see that the range is 0 inclusive, 1 exclusive. So I just do, they are just doing it the same way. I mentioned that they are generating an integer number between 0 and m minus 1, and then they are dividing by m. Okay, so let's use that number. That is my x component of the vector, and then the next number is the y component of the vector. So I'm doing exactly what I had here. I'm populating the elements of the vector. In order to visualize this, so now I could print it, yeah, but in order to visualize this, let's make a small plot. So I generate here lists. So this is the x values, so the sequence of the x values. So I go horizontal through my vector now and just cut out the component. So that is an array list of floating point numbers. And I also like to have, so let's import that. I also like the same for y. So I have y values, so I can add this here. X values should get the new point, and y values should get the new point in y. So because now I can maybe plot this, so I have plots, I have a small helper that can create out of two lists. It can create a plot. So this is the argument x, this is the argument y, this is the argument x min, so it's between 0 and 1, and this is the dot size, so we use 3 points for the dot, and we have a nice little plot, and that plot should be shown. So let's run this small program I did here with you. Okay, and we get a graph that is similar to that I have in the script. We have a two-dimensional sampling of the random numbers. Okay, so maybe I use 1,000 to have a little bit more dots here on the plot. Okay, so looks nice, looks random, no? Really. It's a pseudo-random number generator, but it looks random. Maybe I can run it again. And now if I compare the two, okay, you see it's not the same, okay? So you see, for example, there is a gap here, right? Which is not here, right? But there's a small gap here, there's some hole, which is not here. Okay, these are not the same numbers, okay? So the reason is that we are generating always a different sequence. Actually, the random number is going on and on and on, and it will give us always a different sequence. We can avoid this by using the same Monte Carlo seed or the same random number seed. So here for our linear concurrential generator, we have the fact that if we use the same initial value, we always get the same sequence. And this initial value here is, so this here is the initial value. This initial value is sometimes called the seed. So the seed of the random number generator. Mersenne-Twister also allows us to specify the seed, but it's of course not the initial value of the sequence. The seed is used to generate the initial state of the generator. So an important thing for us here is the random number generator seed. So pseudo random number generators allow us to specify a seed value. The seed is like, yeah, so actually it's only like because it's not always the initial value, but you can think of it being something that determines the initial value. So it determines the sequence. So this means that we get the same sequence for the same seed. So the same seed will generate the same sequence. So why is that important for us? Because using a fixed seed then gives us some reproducibility of our numerical experiments. Different seeds in general generate different sequences. Okay, different seeds generate different sequences. That's also good to know. But note that it's not guaranteed that seeds to sequence are a good proxy for two independent sequences. Yeah, so you have to be careful here. So note that it is not guaranteed that two such sequences with different seeds are a good representation of a drawing of a random vector with IID components. Because think of that the second initial value is just the first value after the initial value of the first initial value. Then you have two different sequences, but they are just shifted by one value. Okay, so be careful when using different seeds. However, sometimes I do that. I just use different seeds to generate different experiments. So we can specify here a seed, yeah, for example, 3141, and we should get the same picture again and again. Okay, so that is this picture with the seed, and then this is this picture with the seed. Okay, and you see it's the same picture, yeah. So there is here this striking structure, okay, and there's here this dot here in the middle and the circle here. And this cluster, it's the same. We get the same sequence. So that's important. And maybe to conclude here with the Monte Carlo seed, let's go back to our experiment from the last session where we did Monte Carlo integration. Okay, so we can run our Monte Carlo integrator test from the last session. So that integrator integrated here the cosine of a function, and it was looking at the difference between the analytic value and the Monte Carlo integration. So where's our Monte Carlo integration? So that here is our Monte Carlo integrator. And I did not specify a seed here for the Monte Carlo integration. So you can specify here a seed, and then you get a certain result. So you see, we get here a certain result with that seed. The error is 0.09, okay? And if we repeat now the Monte Carlo integration, we always get the same result again and again with the same error. If I remove this, he will use always a new seed. So this is now 0.01 is the error. 0.01 again, 1.5, okay? 0.0045, okay, it's better. Okay, so to make the experiment reproducible, it's nice to use some seed. But if you, for example, use here, say, a seed like, say, 58, it may happen that this seed generates a poor result, okay? So we have 0.003 here, so let's use 59 as seed, okay? I have 0.1, and the test is failing. The error is too large. If I use 60, the error is very good, 0.008. If I use 61, test is failing again, okay? So you see that the error is, in this sense, also somehow random, depending on this seed. Or if you use no seed at all here and just run the experiment again, he will use different seeds, and I'm running it. And you see sometimes the error is too large. Okay, I had here this in the test, I had this tolerance. Where was that? Here's my test. I had this tolerance. The tolerance was some constant divided by square root of number of evaluation points. So it was some constant with our Monte Carlo convergence rate. And if you run now this integrator here, always with a different seed, sometimes you are in the interval and sometimes you are outside the interval. Okay, that also illustrates again the random nature of our convergence result. So a small exercise here. Exercise, perform different Monte Carlo integrations with different Monte Carlo seeds. Interpret the result in view of our convergence in theorem 15. So theorem 15 is that guy here. And what we see is if the seed is a little bit like using different omegas here, yeah. So using different seeds, it's a little bit like using different omegas. Then you see that our result holds only in probability because sometimes we have a seed where we lie outside the given range. That was an introduction into random number generation. The next session is quasi-random number generation. And to motivate that and to finish, let's have a look at this picture, and then we can think, okay, that looks random, but is it really good that there are large areas where we see that there are no values? So there are no values here. Is that really good? What if the function is always constant and changes in this region? And then there are some regions where you have many values on the same point, or on a small area. Is that really good? And we can improve the Monte Carlo algorithm by generating a sequence that is more equidistributed. And these are the quasi-random number generators. Thank you.